Buonasera.
Good evening. We are here with Thomas Piketty, one of the most expected events of this festival. I'll be very brief because we're all looking forward to listening to him. Now, the event of Filippotti, which should have been today, will be set for tomorrow. So I kindly ask you to go to the website and look at possible variations. So that was an announcement. Now, this man has two faults. The first was that of working in big and important American universities and centers and then coming back to Europe. This is a fault that the Americans will not forgive him. And the second was that of unveiling some, well, at least this is my opinion, some structures of capitalism and of the current situation in particular. And this is such a severe fault that an important international newspaper mandated a commission of journalists and economists to deny his analysis. And unfortunately, they didn't find any defect, any flaw in his thesis, and then he replied with an article on New York Times. Of course, this book has raised a lot of controversy, of polemics. Well, I believe that there are a couple of facts that are undebatable. That is, disequality, inequality is increasing, and progress is not leading us to a better world, but to a world which is worsening. Now, well, if Piketty says that after 15 years of research and study, together with many researchers, and after examining all data related to wealth and income returns, first of France, UK, and then many other parts in the world, well, then things change, because mine is an opinion and his thesis is a fact, and he will demonstrate that with some diagrams. Now, another couple of comments. Now, he rejected the Légion d'honneur because he criticizes the policies carried out. And the second thing that I appreciated very much in his book is that on page six, but in fact it is the second page, and certainly I read the book throughout, so the second page shows thanks to and recognition to young researchers that helped him. I appreciated that very much. I like that the fact that he shared the global success of this book. Well, this book was first published in America and then it was translated in 30 countries. So right from the start, he wanted to thank the young researchers who helped him in his work. And this is the first step to reduce inequalities, because the person who has a name on this book certainly will have a slightly easier life. And then another point, a phrase, a sentence that I remember, is this one, a sentence that I read in the book. Well, the gist of it is, well, perhaps I'm not quoting perfectly, but he says inequality is not bad per se. Inequality is bad if it is not justified. Well, I think that this is the real point, because he doesn't preach 68-style egalitarianism. He preaches for a juster and fairer society where It doesn't happen as it happens today that there is a huge gap between the wage of a worker and the wage of a CEO. So this is the gist of his work. And now, after my introduction, which I hope was not too superficial, I ask Professor Piketty to take the floor and well, I have to say that this is a heavy book in a way. I always try to read it in bed, and my wife, a poor woman, had to bear with me. And sometimes I had some difficulties in going on with the book, but the book is very easy. And I'm sure that Professor Piketty will be able to share with us the essence of the book.
Well, thank you. Thanks a lot. I'm very, very happy to be there in Trento for the second time. And thanks to the organizers. You know, this book, I think, you know, I should apologize first that my English sounds a lot like French, and I hope it will be possible to understand. I should also apologize that I, you know, for writing such a long book, and, you know, maybe it's a bit too long. But on the other hand, there are reasons for this. So this book is really based on a very collective research program. As you mentioned, many young researchers have participated to this research program, and also less young researchers, starting with Tony Atkinson, who is sitting there in the first rank in this room, and who has played an enormous role to promote historical study on income and wealth distribution. Kuznets started the process in the 1950s, and then starting in the 1970s, 80s, Tony Atkinson played an absolutely huge role. I first met Tony as a student at London School of Economics 25 years ago. You know, I'm very happy that we have done so much together. And I would like to make clear that, you know, I am the only one responsible for the mistakes that stay in the book, but I am certainly not the only one responsible for collecting all the data that I present in the book, which could never have happened without over 30 researchers from over 20 countries, starting with Tony Atkinson. So I would really start by paying tribute to Tony, and thanks a lot, Tony, for everything. So in this presentation, I'm going to show you some results from the book. Of course, there is no way I can present everything, but if you go on this website, at least you will see all the statistical material, all the graphs and figures and tables. So I am sorry that I cannot put the book online, but my publisher, and I would like to thank Bompiani also for publishing my book in Italian, would probably disagree if I do that. So, but at least you have all the statistical series online, so you can have a good sense of the material that I cover in this book. Let me say also that, you know, this is mostly a book about history. We have collected a very large historical database. And let me say very clearly that in the last part of the book, I try to draw conclusions about the future, but I don't ask you to agree with all of my conclusions. And you know, I am much better at analyzing the past than the future. And ultimately, the objective is not so much to tell you, you know, this is the conclusion about the future, but rather to help readers to make their own mind about these important issues. This is a big book, but I think this is a readable book. I think it can be read by anyone. It takes a bit of time, but what I really try to show in this book is that the history of income and wealth is not simply an economic history. It is also a social, a cultural, a political history. And ultimately, it is really the interaction between this economic evolution and the political and social processes, and in particular, the representation that people make of inequality are very important. That's why I talk about this representation both in the political debate, also in the literature, because I think ultimately these popular beliefs and perceptions about the economy and inequality determine the institutions, the legal system. There's never anything natural in economic evolution. These are always man-made evolutions that depend on the institution and legal system we choose. And my general conclusion is that, you know, there are always alternatives. When you look in the past, you observe inequality crises in the past, you observe public debt crises in the past, even bigger than the public debt crises we have today in Europe. And the good news is that we've always found solutions in the past. And there are always different solutions. There's no easy solution, but there are different ways, for instance, to reduce large public debt. You can do it in a slow manner by accumulating a budget surplus with very low inflation. But in history, you also see countries, in particular Germany and France in the 20th century, which never repaid their public debt because there was a lot of debt repudiation, inflation. And, you know, it's a bit ironical, of course, that that these countries now, in particular Germany, is explaining sometimes the rest of Europe that you have to pay back everything with zero inflation, in spite of the fact that Germany was a country which never repaid its public debt in the 20th century. So I think studying history, it's also important because historical amnesia is a big risk, in particular in Europe today. And so I was, I heard the debate earlier this afternoon between Renzi and Valls, and this was very interesting. And Renzi said that the austerity in Europe should stop in September, I think he said. So I don't know why September and not now, but well. Anyway, I thought this was good news, and now Valls did not really answer. You know, Valls said, I want reform, I don't want revolution. I say, okay, that sounds reasonable, but I didn't really hear the answer apart from that. But anyway, here I'm going to show you mostly historical results, but I will also talk a little bit about the implications for today's situation, in particular in the Eurozone. So let me start right away. I'm going to try to make 3 points in this presentation. The first point will be about the long-run dynamics of income inequality. In the second and third point, I will talk more about wealth than about income. So I will talk in the second point about the return of a patrimonial or wealth-based society with higher wealth-to-income ratio. And I will also talk about the metamorphosis of capital, the role of the public debt. And in the final point, I will talk about the future of the concentration of wealth rather than simply the aggregate value of wealth relative to national income. And I will talk about the role of the gap between the rate of return and the growth rate. But let me start first with the long-run dynamics of income inequality and the way the data that we have collected has changed, I think, substantially the beliefs, in particular in the Kuznets curve, and probably the general conclusion is the end of universal laws about income inequality dynamics and the importance of country-specific institutions and policies. So regarding income, most of the data that I use in the book comes from this website, the World Top Income Database. So the countries in red or maybe black are already in the database, and the countries in blue, like Brazil or Algeria, are about to enter the database. So in fact, this map is not entirely up to date, like Mexico should be in blue, for instance, because we try to put more and more countries online all the time. And this is really thanks to a big network of researchers. I quoted, of course, Tony Atkinson. Facundo Alvaredo from Argentina plays a very important role, and many other researchers from around the world. And I should say that one very positive impact of the publication of my book is that it induced more government to let us access fiscal data that we could not use before. So, for instance, now we are able to access historical fiscal data for Brazil, for Mexico, for Taiwan, for Korea, for which we didn't have a series in the book. So, I should apologize that emerging countries are not as present in the book that I would like them to be. It's not that I'm not interested. India is in the book, China is in the book, but it's just that in many other countries we could not access the data. But we are making progress, and we are putting more and more data online all the time. So what does it mean to be in this database? It means that we try to exploit, we try to collect and use all the historical data on incomes that we could find for a given country. And usually the oldest source of information about income comes from the income tax itself. So the income tax was created in 1913 in the United States, in 1914 In France, in Britain, there was an income tax in the 19th century, but it became a progressive tax on global comprehensive income in 1908, 1909. In Japan or Germany, it was a bit before, in the late 19th century. In some countries, it was closer to 1920. But in most countries, it's between 1900 and 1920 that you have the creation of the modern income tax, which gives us data, which, of course, is not perfect. But that's much better than no data at all. And, you know, in the 19th century, when you don't have an income tax, you know very little about income. So, like in France, you know, you have the contribution des portes et fenêtres, the contribution on doors and windows in the 19th century. So you have lots of fantastic data on the number of doors and windows by department, which is very interesting. But, you know, income is arguably a better indicator of the economic resources that are available to the different social groups. So it's important to have in mind that taxation is always more than just taxation. It's also a way to produce information about society. It's a way to produce legal categories, statistical categories, which can then be used by society in order to better know what's happening to us and how the distribution of resources is changing. And for the 19th century, we don't have much income data. But at least we have wealth data, because the taxation of wealth, in particular the taxation of wealth at the time of transmission, when you transmit property from one generation to the other, is much older than the taxation of income. In France, you have a relatively modern inheritance tax that was created at the time of the French Revolution, so you can trace back the history of wealth from the late 18th century, which gives us a longer perspective, as we will see. So let me show you one example of what we find for the evolution of income inequality. So I will describe a number of graphs like this. To summarize, you know, I'm going to present three facts about inequality in the long run: one about income inequality, one about wealth inequality, and another about wealth income ratio. And they are all taken from this paper that we published in Science with my friend and co-author Emmanuel Saez last year, which the good thing about articles in Science is that they have to be very short. So it's like a 5-page article. So if you don't want to read the book, you know, you can still read this 5-page article. You don't have all the book in it, but at least it's a summary. So fact number one that we find is that if you compare US and Europe, you find a big reversal in inequality over the course of the 20th century. So one century ago, there used to be more income inequality in Europe than in the US, and today it is the opposite. There's a lot higher inequality in the US. So let me show you again this graph. So this is a simple indicator of inequality. This is the share of total pre-tax income going to the top 10%. So you can see in 1900, 1910, it was higher in Europe, whereas today it is a lot higher in the US. So there was a big decline between 1910 and 1950, 1960, and then a big increase starting around 1970, 1980, particularly in the US. So Europe, as you know, Europe is a complicated continent. So here what I call Europe is the GDP-weighted average of France, Germany, Italy, Britain. So this is a big part of Europe, and the evolutions are roughly comparable in many European countries. So I think it makes sense to have this big comparison. But of course, you have the detailed country series on this website if you want to look at them. So what's interesting is to try to understand, you know, why is it? How can we explain this evolution? And when Kuznets wrote in the 1950s, so Kuznets was the first economist, so Kuznets was an American economist who was the first one to compute national accounts for the US together with other colleagues. And then in the 1950s, he was also the first one to use historical income tax data in order to compute the evolution, exactly this kind of evolution, the share of national income going to the top 10%. And he came with this optimistic conclusion, which was a decline in inequality between roughly 1910 and 1950. Now, all what we've done with Tony and many other colleagues is to extend the work of Kuznets to many more countries and many more years. And as you can see, this gives us a different perspective, because you can see that the reduction of inequality that took place between 1910 and 1950, and which gave rise to the very optimistic theory of the Kuznets curve in the 1950s, according to which you have a natural reduction of inequality in advanced stages of development, well, has been reversed very sharply, particularly in the US. So if you look in a more detailed manner, so these are the annual series, whereas these were decennial averages. So decennial averages means that you take average over 10 years, so everything looks very smooth, but the real world is not smooth at all. You know, when you look at an annual perspective, you can see in particular at the end of the period the stock market cycle. So I think both perspectives, the decennial perspective and the annual perspective, are useful. And in the book, I try to move from one to the other. You know, you have very long run evolution, but you also have a lot of action at the annual level. So in particular, you can see when you have a stock market crash in 2001, 2002, or again in 2008, 2009, this is not a good time to make capital gains. You know, this is not a good time to have big stock options or to have a big bonus. So you have a reduction in the top shares. But after the crisis, you know, you can see in 2012, the US in terms of inequality is already higher than before the crisis 2007. And 2007 was already higher than the previous high point, which was 1928. So you have this huge variation, which have a lot to do with the financial cycle, but it's more than just the financial cycle. You know, if you take away capital gains entirely, you still have this clear increase in inequality. So how can we explain this evolution? You know, so you have, you know, the US, you have Europe. Let me maybe show a third country, which is Japan, you know, which is the other part of the rich world, if you want. You have the US, Europe, and Japan. And you can see Japan is sort of in between Europe and the US. So you have a bigger rise in inequality in Japan than in Europe, but much smaller than in the US. So in the entire rich world, in all countries, you have an increase in inequality over the past 2 to 3 decades, but with different magnitude. You know, it's not the same everywhere. So in particular, the rise of US inequality in recent decades at this stage is mostly due to rising inequality of labor income. Rising inequality of wealth and capital income is starting to play a big role, as recent research by Saez and Zuckman has shown. But for the most part, until this time period, labor income plays the dominant role. So how can we explain rising inequality of labor income? It is certainly due to a mixture of reasons. You know, the standard economic explanation will be changing a pattern of supply and demand for skills, race between education and technology, globalization. So, you know, the standard story, in particular in the US, you hear this story a lot, will be, okay, you have globalization, you have China entering the world labor market, if you want, so a big inflow of low-skilled workers. This is putting pressure on the low-skilled and medium-skilled workers in rich countries. This leads to rising inequality, and that's it. And there's not much you can do about it because it's just globalization, and globalization is good, at least for emerging countries. So you're not going to change it. So there's nothing that can be done. I think it's part of the explanation. You know, certainly globalization is very important. Changing pattern of supply and demand for skill is certainly very important. But this cannot be the entire explanation, because otherwise you would have the same rise in inequality everywhere. You know, globalization happened not only in the US. You know, sometimes US economists tend to be a bit US-centric. You know, I like them a lot for their energy, but, you know, sometimes they view the world a little bit just from the viewpoint of one country. But, you know, globalization also happened in Japan, it also happened in Germany, it also happened in Sweden, in Italy, in France, in the UK, and you don't have the same rise of inequality everywhere. So you need explanations that are more than just globalization. So maybe, you know, if we take the standard skill-based explanation on supply and demand of skill, one explanation could be that you have a more unequal supply of skill in the US, so in particular more unequal access to skills, that this could be due to rising tuition fees and insufficient public investment in US universities. You also have an unprecedented rise of top managerial compensation in the US, which are difficult to explain simply by rising returns to skill. You know, when you see top managers who increase their pay from $1 million to $10 million, you know, is this due to their higher skill and higher productivity? you know, I'm not so sure, at least we could not find evidence in the data that this came with more performance, more job creation, etc. So I think above a certain level, pay determination has a lot to do with sometimes your ability to put the right people in the right compensation committee, and maybe, you know, changing incentives in the US corporate governance system, cuts in top income tax rate. I will show you at the end of this talk that in the US there has been a huge decline in top income tax rate over this period, which probably has changed the nature of the incentives for top managers to try to bargain very aggressively for higher pay. The falling minimum wage in the US and the decline of unions, changing labor market institutions probably played a big role as well. Now, whatever the exact combination, you know, people can disagree about the relative importance of unequal access to education, corporate governance, fiscal policy, labor market policy. But in any case, the general conclusion is that institutions and policies matter. And, you know, there are different ways to organize globalization and to react to globalization so that broader groups in the population can benefit from it. So the extent to which inequality rises in response to globalization really depends on the policies that we choose. So just to get two examples of this, minimum wage, you know, just look at this comparison between France and the US. So this is the real value of the minimum wage in France and in the US expressed in euros or dollars of 2013. So the scale for France is on the left-hand side, the scale for the US is on the right-hand side, but it's roughly the same level in terms of purchasing power, because I've taken €1 for $1.2, which is roughly the purchasing power parity. So what you can see is that the minimum wage used to be a lot lower in France, and it is now a lot higher in France. And in fact, in France, some people believe it's too high, especially because you have very big payroll tax in addition to this is the gross minimum wage, but you have employer payroll tax on the top of that. And, you know, I don't want to enter into this discussion, but, you know, this is a legitimate subject of discussion. But whether or not it's too high in France, you know, I think it's too low in the US. You know, I think it's quite incredible to see a country where you have an absolute decline in the purchasing power of the minimum wage over half a century. You know, the minimum wage in the US, the federal minimum wage in the US, so you have some states which have higher minimum wage, but the federal level is right now is $7.2 per hour. It used to be over $10 per hour in the late 1960s. And the unemployment rate at that time was not higher than what it is today. So the country was still employing 95% of its labor force, but with a higher real value of the minimum wage. So that's quite unusual for a country to have an absolute decline over such a long time period. So I'm not saying that that the only solution is just to increase the minimum wage, but you know, I think Obama proposed to increase it to $9 or $10, and probably this will not happen given the majority in Congress, but I think this would probably be a reasonable policy, together with more investment in skills and education. Of course, it's much easier to sustain a higher minimum wage if you, at the same time, you invest in skills so that people can take high productivity jobs. But this is just an example where clearly policy matters, and you know, these choices depend on representations of inequality, changing political system, the financing of political parties, or you know, all sorts of dimensions. Let me show you another important dimension of inequality, which is access to education. So this graph is taken from work done by Emmanuel Saez and Raj Shetty and other co-authors. And I think it's quite an incredible graph. You have, on the horizontal axis, you have your parental income rank. So 10 means that you are in the bottom 10% in terms of parental income, and 90 means that you are in the top 10%. Okay? And here is the percentage attending college, so the first 3 or 4 years of university, when you're age 18 to 21. And this is measured for the generation who are 18 to 21 roughly today, around 2010. Okay? Now, you can see that you have almost a straight line. So you go almost from 0 to 100. Well, not exactly. You know, when your parents are really poor, you still have a 20% chance of accessing college. And when your parents are very rich, you don't have 100%, you just have 90%. So it's not exactly 0 to 100, you know, but it's 20 to 90. And this is really quite impressive because, you know, in addition, of course, the people at the top who go to college, they don't go to the same college as the people at the bottom. So in my book, I give data showing that the average income of the parents of Harvard University students right now corresponds to the average income of the top 2% of the US distribution of family income. So this doesn't mean that nobody from below the top two goes to Harvard. You have some people from below the top two, but they are sufficiently few, and the people who come from the top two are sufficiently high within the top two that the overall average is as if all the students had been picked at random just within the top 2%. So I think this is an area where the gap between the official meritocratic discourse about equal opportunity and the mobility of US society, et cetera, and the reality is particularly striking. Okay, so I think there's a tendency within the winners of the economic system, the winners of the game, to sometimes there's a lot of hypocrisy. You know, there's a tendency to justify inequality on the basis of equal opportunity, which has just little to do with the facts and with what's happening. And you know, I think this may be particularly extreme in the U.S. because of very high tuition fees. But let me say very clearly that you have a lot of hypocrisy everywhere, you know, including in Italy and including, of course, in my country, in France, where sometimes we can put, you know, 3 times or 4 times more public resources for the students who go to the very elite school with very privileged backgrounds than we put in the basic universities where the more disadvantaged students go to. So I think in every country, you know, the meritocratic discourse are used very often as a veil to justify inequalities which are everything except fair. So I think it's important to put this discourse under public scrutiny and collect more data of this sort. In my book, I compare a little bit, like I mentioned Harvard for the US. If you take Sciences Po for France, the average income of the students of the parents of Harvard, of Sciences Po students corresponds to the average income of the top 9% in France. So, you know, it's a bit better than the top 2%. You know, it's a four to five times bigger group, but you know, it's still it has little to do with equal opportunity. And you know, we should be able to have more data on this. So let me move now to the second point. So let me now move from income to wealth. So you know, wealth inequality, of course, is partly the consequence of income inequality. When you have large inequality in wages, you have large inequality in your ability to accumulate wealth, transmit wealth to the next generation. So, of course, that's one of the primary determinants of wealth inequality. But there are other forces which play a role, and now I'm going to talk about these other forces. But that doesn't mean that all the forces I've talked about already are not important for wealth. They are, of course. Let me come now to these other forces. So the second point which I'm now going to make has to do with what I call in the book the return of patrimonial or wealth-based society, which is particularly strong in Europe and Japan, where wealth-to-income ratio seem to be returning to very high levels. That's particularly true in Europe and Japan because you have low population growth, and you know the intuition is that in a slow population growth society, wealth accumulated in the past can naturally become very important. And in the very long run, you know, I will argue that this can be relevant for the entire world. This is not necessarily bad in itself, but this creates new challenges, in particular because in order to understand this evolution, we need to look at what I call the metamorphosis of capital, the fact that some relative price, like the price of real estate, for instance, can be changing in very important proportion. And this has very strong consequences, for instance, for the ability of young generation to access property. So this calls for new challenges and new forms of regulation of property relation and access to property. So let me first say that, you know, you remember I started with a fact number one, which was the big reversal of income inequality over the 20th century. Now let me move to fact number two, which is the same evolution but about wealth inequality. And again, we have a reversal in the sense that inequality of wealth is now higher in the US than in Europe, and the opposite was true a century ago. But Fact number three is that wealth inequality is still less extreme today than it was a century ago, although the total capitalization of private wealth relative to national income has now almost recovered from the big shocks due to the World War. So that's why it's important to differentiate the analysis of the total capitalization of wealth, on which I'm going to focus now, from the distribution. And you know, to some extent, we can separate the two issues, although only to some extent. So let me first show the graph for the evolution of wealth inequality. So you can see, again, the reversal with the US that is now more unequal than Europe. You can also see that the level of wealth inequality are always very high. You know, remember, you know, the exact numbers, you should not remember all exact numbers, but the orders of magnitude, I think, are interesting to remember. So for income inequality, the orders of magnitude was that the share going to the top 10% will go from 30 to 50%. These are the typical order of magnitude. You know, very equal country like Scandinavia would have less than 30%, maybe sometimes 25%, and very unequal country would have 50%, like the US today, or Brazil, maybe even more than 50%. For wealth inequality, it's always more than 50% for the top 10, and it typically goes from 60% to even 90% if you take European countries at the eve of World War I. Okay, so you have an extreme concentration of wealth in every European country for which we have data until World War I, you know, including in France, where you know at that time there was a big discourse by a big part of the Republican elite to say, well, you know, we've made the French Revolution, so basically now we are a society of equals. You know, we don't need to create an income tax, we don't need to create a progressive inheritance tax. This is a problem for Britain because they are an aristocratic country. Sorry, Tony, but for France, you know, that's not necessary. Well, in fact, when you look at the data, the concentration of wealth in 1913, 1914 was almost as extreme in France than in Britain, largely because at that time, landed estates, you know, land, agricultural land, was not a very important part of national wealth. So, you know, big landed estates, you know, are important, like in Downton Abbey, but in the real life, they were only a small part of national wealth of Britain or France at that time. So the fact that you don't have an aristocracy, you know, was not really essential. So the wealth concentration was extremely high. Now, today, it is less extreme. In particular, you know, what you should have in mind is that whatever does not belong to the top 10% belongs to what I call in the book the patrimonial middle class, which is the middle 40%, which are not in the top 10 and which are not in the bottom half. The bottom half basically owns very little wealth, you know, less than 10% and usually less than 5% of aggregate wealth in every country for which we have data. So whatever does not belong to the top 10 belongs to the middle 40. And so, you know, this decline in inequality, you know, you can still think that inequality of wealth is very high, but at least this means that the middle class now owns 20 to 30% of aggregate wealth, whereas they would own less than 10% a century ago, where there would be no middle class. The middle class would be just as poor as the poor. So I think this is still a big change. Now the question is, will the middle class shrink in the future, which is a little bit what you have here with an increase of the top 10% share at the expense of the middle 40%, or will it expand? You know, that's one of the big questions. In order to understand this, it's also useful to have in mind another graph, which is the aggregate value of wealth. Okay? And you can see that in Europe, you know, the aggregate value of wealth fell to very low level after World War I and World War II, and it has recovered, and it is now higher than in the US. And so this is what we need to understand. So in order to understand this kind of evolution, we have to open the black box of wealth and look more at what's in this aggregate wealth holding. So, you know, you see this increase in the wealth to income ratio or capital to income ratio in Germany, in France, in the UK. You also see it in Italy, as I will show you in a minute. But in order to understand this evolution, you need to consider what I call the metamorphosis of capital. You know, the fact that you have, you know, a multi-dimensional approach to the history of capital and property relations, which I try to develop in my book, that is necessary to understand this. So you need to look at the transformation from land to business assets, foreign assets, real estate, public debt, immaterial capital. All these different kinds of assets have a different story, involve different mechanisms, different institutions. And one reason why the book is relatively long is that I try to tell this story in a relatively detailed manner. So let me give you some of the ingredients. So this is the evolution of wealth for the United Kingdom. So I include in capital or wealth all the assets that can be owned by private individuals or sometimes by the government on a permanent basis and that can be exchanged on the market. So usually this does not include human capital except in slave societies where you can exchange on the market human labor, but usually this is not the case, at least in the recent period. So you can see that today, if you take a country like Britain, half of wealth is housing, and half of wealth is other domestic capital, which are basically the business assets that are used by companies and also a little bit by the government. This includes immaterial capital in the sense that we value business assets by the stock market capitalization. So whatever research and development was invested in order to produce patents or other forms of immaterial capital, that will be included in there as valued by the market. Now, you can see that when you go back to the 18th century, agricultural land was a lot more important. So now agricultural land has disappeared. Well, it is still there, but its value is very small. Of course, this evolution of the share of agricultural land is just the same as the evolution as the share of agriculture in GDP. So, you know, it's not too surprising, you know, if agriculture goes from 2/3 of GDP to 1%, it's not too surprising that the share of agricultural land of national capital. So this is, you know, what's interesting is that you have this metamorphosis of capital from agricultural land to housing, business assets, but in the end, the total value today is returning to levels which are not too different from what we had in the 18th and 19th century. You know, the orders of magnitude are, I think, are okay. You know, the exact measurement, of course, are complicated, but the orders of magnitude, I think, are reliable. You can see that the big decline between 1910 and 1950, this has a lot to do with the war, of course. So in particular, you can see the net foreign capital, so which was very important for the UK. These are the assets that British residents, sometimes the British government, but mostly the British private wealth holders would own in the rest of the world. Okay? Now, in 1950, this is down to zero. Well, this is because largely to pay for the war, British wealth holders had to sell some of their private assets in the rest of the world in order to buy government bonds to finance the war, and which were then inflated away in 1950, and there was no, in terms of national wealth, you have no national wealth left, and all the net foreign capital has disappeared. You have the same evolution in France, except that net foreign capital was not as big, and that agriculture, it took more time for agriculture to disappear in France or to reach a different, but you have the same general evolution. It's important to have in mind also that when you have this big decline in the value of wealth, it does not reflect only a volume effect where you lose some assets or you destroy some assets in the case of France or Germany due to the war, but it also reflects a price effect. So it's also that the price of assets around 1950, 1960 is much lower than in 1910. And in some cases, this was actually the outcome of a policy. So this was a choice. So if you take rent control, rent control was deliberately an attempt to reduce the value of housing rent and therefore of housing price, which were very low in 1950, 1960 in Britain, in France, in Germany, in many other countries. And we estimate in our paper with Zuckman, we have a paper in QJ published last year where we do the decomposition. You know, the numbers are not perfect, but we estimate that the price effect explained between 30% and 50% of the total decline in the capital to income ratio between 1910 and 1950. Maybe around 30% in France, Germany, where you had a lot of physical destruction, and up to 50% in Britain, where you had limited physical asset destruction on UK soil. So, you know, the orders of magnitude are important. You still have half or more than half that corresponds to lack of investment during this period, but the price effect are very important. And in the same way, if you look at the big increase in the wealth-to-income ratio in the recent period, you know, the huge increase in housing prices plays a major role. So it's not just new volume of capital that are being accumulated. It's also their relative price that has increased. Now, this is a more general evolution than just France and Britain. So let me look now in a more detailed way at the more recent period, well, you know, 1970 to 2010. Let me look again at annual series rather than these big decennial averages so that we can zoom on some recent episodes. So first thing is that you can see that in every country, so look, Italy is at the top of the class, so you know that's a very interesting case. So this is private household wealth divided by national income. So these are the top 8 developed economies in the world. So you can see that every country was between 2 and 3.5 years of national income in private wealth, and now every country in 2010 was between 4 and 7 years. So there's clearly a big general increase. So that's interesting because, you know, sometimes in economic textbook, you hear that the ratio of wealth to income or capital to output should be a constant. But as you can see, you know, this doesn't look too much like a constant. So, you know, you should be careful with textbooks. You know, sometimes in economics, when we don't know much about something, we just assume it's a constant, which, of course, if you have only one data point, everything is a constant. But in fact, there's really no reason why it should be a constant. You know, even in the simplest economic model with one good, where, you know, you produce apples and capital is just a big pile of apples, which is a little bit of a stupid model because I don't know what you will do with a pile of apples. But, you know, economists like this simple model with one good. But even in this model, the capital to output ratio can take any value. You know, it really depends if you have labor capital substitution. It really depends on how much you save and invest relative to how fast you grow in terms of population and productivity growth. And any ratio could be an equilibrium. Now, when you move to more sophisticated and more realistic model where you have several sectors, and, you know, capital accumulation is not just a pile of apples, but you have real estate, you have business assets, immaterial capital, and the relative price between these different assets is changing a lot, then this creates even more uncertainty about the value of the capital to income ratio. And a big part of this evolution has to do with all this big movement in relative price. You know, it's difficult to put a price on assets. It's always, you know, some people do that for a living and sometimes are very successful, sometimes are less successful, but, you know, it's always difficult to put a price either on a company, on the stock market, or a building. You know, you have to make all sorts of assumptions about who's going to pay rent to live in this building, who's going to buy the goods of these companies. And this creates a lot of uncertainty. So look at Japan between 1985 and 1990. You know, they go from a private wealth of 500%, so 5 years of national income, to a private wealth of 700%. So they increase their wealth by 2 years of national income in just 4 years. Now, even with the Japanese saving rate, that's not possible because, you know, even if you save 50%, you will need to save 50% net of depreciation, which never happened. You know, even when you have saving rate or investment rate of 30 to 40%, a big part is depreciation, just repairing and replacing the capital stock. So, you know, this is, of course, a bubble. This is a well-known Japanese bubble in real estate price where, well, there is also saving. You know, it's not that the Japanese were not saving at all, but a very big part of this huge increase was a very big bubble in asset prices. Now, look at the Spanish bubble over there. You know, this is even bigger than the Japanese one. Now, and starting in 2007, of course, this has started to decline, and right now this is still declining. I mean, right now we are around 700% in Spain, so this is still high by historical standards, but this has declined a lot in recent years. So the fact that one part of the explanation for this is this sharp movement in real estate prices and sometimes stock market prices. Now, the fact that we have this very high wealth-to-income ratio is not a problem in itself, as I would say in a minute, but clearly this creates new challenges because this means, for instance, that prudential regulation, financial regulation is very important. Because if you make a mistake on the price of your real estate when your ratio is 8 years of national income, you know, if you just make a 10% mistake, this can have huge consequences for the real economy. Whereas when the ratio was 2 to 3 years, you know, it was sort of less important. So higher wealth to income ratio is not bad in itself, but it creates new policy challenges, in particular in terms of regulation, financial regulation. It also has implication for inequality between social groups, and in particular inequality between the young generation and the old generation. So typically when you have this very high wealth to income ratio with very high real estate price, it means that the young generation who don't have family wealth, if they want to access property, if you want to buy an apartment in Madrid or Rome or Paris or London at the end of the period, just with your labor income, as you know, this will have to be a very high labor income, you know, as compared to the situation right here. So this means a return to a role of inheritance, family wealth. You know, the logical conclusion in terms of tax policy will probably be that when you have this very high wealth to income ratio, probably you should tax labor income, in particular low wage, middle wage labor income, a bit less, and tax higher capital income, accumulated property inheritance, probably a bit more. But now, because of tax competition between countries, we tend to do the opposite. So the evolution over this period, in fact, probably has exacerbated this evolution that we see here, rather than to limit them. Let me now mention another issue which is quite important, particularly for Italy, which is the comparison between private and public capital. Okay. So what is public capital? Well, public capital is defined in the same way as private capital. This is the difference between the assets and the debt. Okay? So you can see Italy is a very interesting country because Italy is at the top of the class for private capital and at the bottom for public capital. And why is it so? So it's actually negative in Italy, which means that according to the official balance sheets of the bank made by the Bank of Italy, even if the Italian government was to sell all the public assets, all the public schools and public hospitals and public financial assets, although there are limited financial assets, but even if the government was to sell all of them, this would not be enough to reimburse the public debt. So this is what a negative public capital means. Now, why is it that the same country which has the lower public capital has the higher private capital? Well, because someone has to buy the public debt and the privatized assets, okay? So the private sector, private Italian households, by and large, have bought some of the privatized assets and have bought some of the public debt. So the two, you know, are related. Also, you know, over this period, it's important to see that private wealth has increased a lot more than the decline of public wealth. So, you know, I don't know if you can read this, but so in Italy, private capital rose from 240 to 680% of national income between 1970 and 2010, while public capital dropped from plus 20 to minus 70. So the drop, the reduction in public capital is about 1 year of national income. The increase in private is about 4 years. So if you want to summarize, it's about one quarter of the increase in private capital, which corresponds to a transfer, if you want, of public to private wealth. So you still have three quarters that are not due to this, which is, in a way, this is good news. You know, it's good. You know, sometime in Europe, we feel that, you know, we should be very guilty for the public debt we are going to leave to our children, and you know, we should feel really bad. And, you know, of course, we should feel very, very bad with respect to our children all the time. But, you know, here it's important to realize that we are going to leave a lot of public debt to our children, of course, but we are also going to leave a lot of private wealth to our children, or at least for those of us who have private wealth to transmit. And the increase in private wealth relative to GDP has been a lot higher than the increase in public debt. So in other words, if you take national wealth, which is the sum of private and public, it's actually higher than what it used to be. So, you know, this is partly not such a good news because this is due to excessive real estate price in some cases, sometimes of excessive power of shareholders, and having high market valorization of a company is not necessarily good in itself, as I show in my book when I compare the market value, for instance, of German companies with British or French companies. So it's a lot more complicated than just good news that we have a lot of private wealth to compare to the public wealth. But at least, you know, this is a better situation that if we only had debt. Okay? So it's important to realize that European countries are rich. It is our governments which are poor, which creates a number of difficulties, but you know, it's a much better situation than if we were all poor. And sometimes in France, you know, people imagine that we are being owned by the Emir of Qatar or the Bank of China. Well, you know, if we keep having this bad policy in Europe, maybe this will happen, but for the time being, this is not at all the situation. You know, the assets, foreign assets owned by Eurozone residents in the rest of the world are higher than the financial assets owned by the rest of the world in the Eurozone. So our public debt is internal, and in fact, even we own part of the assets of the, of the, of the rest of the world. So it's a matter of organization. And, you know, in Italy, you know, of course, I will not recommend selling the public assets in order to reimburse the public debt. Many of us will be shocked, you know, if we had to pay rent to the owners, the private owners of the school to which we send our children. So I'm certainly not saying we should do this, but it's important to realize that in a way, this is already what we are doing. Because when you pay interest payment on the public debt, which are higher than the rental value of the public assets, so it is the same. It's a bit more abstract because it goes through the financial intermediation system. But right now, a country like Italy is paying 4-5% of GDP in interest payment each year, whereas the total budget of the entire university system is about 1% of GDP. So is this the right way to prepare the future for the future generation? You know, I am not so sure. And as I mentioned in my introduction, it's a bit ironical that this is not at all, you know, what was done for Germany or France or, in fact, also Italy in the post-war period, where the public debt was basically inflated away or renegotiated away, restructured so that Germany and France and other European countries could invest in public infrastructure, invest in education, invest in growth. And so, you know, I'm very concerned that we might not remember this lesson today. So let me skip this because I don't have time. Although there are interesting issues about the value of corporations in Germany relative to other countries, which I cannot really discuss. I just want to very quickly address the last point, which is the role of the gap between the rate of return, the net of tax rate of return, and the gross rate. And I think an important part of the future of wealth concentration will have to do with this gap. You know, real estate is important, land prices are very important, but I think financial rates of return are also important. You know, the history of inequality is a complicated story, and you know, if everything could be explained with just one mechanism, my book would be 50 pages long, and if it's long, it's because it's a complicated book. Lots of things are happening at the same time. And so let me mention this issue about financial rate of return. Maybe let me go directly to this and conclude with this, and with maybe, one table after that. You give me, how long do you give me? 3 minutes, 4 minutes?
3 minutes.
Yes, okay, that's exactly what I need, good. So, this is data coming from the Forbes ranking of wealth. So Forbes publishes world rankings of billionaires starting in 1987. So, of course, these are not the same people over time. You know, the people at the top of the list in 1987 are Japanese billionaires, which everybody has forgotten, and people at the top of the list in 2013 are Bill Gates or Carlos Slim from Mexico. Now, what's interesting is that if you take a fixed fraction of the world population and you look at the speed at which their average wealth has been increasing, you can see that they have increased pretty fast, you know, 6 to 7% per year in real terms, whereas average wealth in the world has increased at only 1 to 2% per year. So, you know, the fact that you have mobility in wealth, you have new people coming down, new people coming up, of course, that's very good. You know, it's very useful to have new entrepreneurs. But in itself, this cannot explain, you know, why the average wealth at the top is rising 3 to 4 times faster than the average wealth in the world. Because if we are in an equilibrium of the world distribution of wealth, you know, the people going down should more or less compensate for the people going up, and the average wealth at the top should increase more or less at the same speed as average wealth in the world. You know, it's okay to have rich people, middle people, poor people, as long as everybody in the long run rises approximately at the same speed. You know, you cannot have the top average wealth at the top rising at 6 to 7% per year, 3 to 4 times faster than average wealth in the world forever. Otherwise, the share of world wealth going to billionaires will converge toward 100%. in 40 or 50 years, which everybody would agree is too much. So I'm not saying this will go so far, but I'm saying that, you know, this could go quite far. And it would be a mistake to just rely on natural forces to stabilize the process at a level that is acceptable or socially efficient in any meaningful way. So how can we explain this? I think part of it are privatization over this period. You know, you have huge privatization, not only in Italy and France, but if you take, you know, Russian oligarchs, you know, it's not that they have become rich by saving. You know, they just became owners of, you know, Qatari oligarchs. So, you know, you have a lot of private appropriation of public assets over this period. So there's not much less left to privatize. So this part of the story should stop at some point. Now, there could be other mechanisms. So in particular, you can see that with financial deregulation, it is possible that the inequality in access to high financial returns has increased. So, you know, when we talk of R minus G versus G, it's important to realize that not everybody is getting the same R. You know, the rate of return is not the same for everybody. So here I'm using data from university endowments in the US. The reason I'm showing you this data is that because at least these people publish data. So we know what they do with their endowment. And you can see that they're doing pretty well. And that the higher the initial endowments, the higher the return. So, of course, this is not due to land or housing. You know, this is a different issue. You know, this is due to the use of very sophisticated financial derivatives, the complex financial instruments, which you can access only if you have a very large financial portfolio. So if you take the case of Harvard, they spend in average management cost. So these are real rate of return after deduction of inflation, after deduction of all management cost. Now, the management cost for Harvard endowment right now are only 0.3% of the endowment each year. But because the endowment is $40 billion, this is still more than $100 million each year. So if you can spend $100 million each year to pay a good team of wealth managers, you know, even if these people are very costly, if this allows you to get a return of 10 rather than 8 or 6 or 4, it's okay. Now, of course, if you have an endowment of 100 million, you're not going to spend 100 million each year in management cost. And if all what you have is 10,000 euros or 100,000 euros, you know, maybe you will ask advice to your brother-in-law for your investment, and you know, maybe you will get 1% or 0%. So I think this, you know, I'm not saying this is the old story. There are many other forces, privatization, movement in relative asset prices, but, you know, this can be quite powerful and this can contribute to rising inequality. Let me stop there and say that, you know, in terms of solution, in terms of taxation, you know, this is the evolution of top income tax rate in US, UK, Germany, France. This is the evolution of top tax rate on inheritance. You know, I'm not going to describe this graph, just to conclude that, you know, the history of inequality and also the history of taxation and redistribution is a very complicated and chaotic story. And, you know, 100 years ago, people would have said that the income tax would never happen. And then, you know, it happened. And you had, you know, 70%, 80%, 90% top tax rate, in particular in the US. If you make the average between 1930 and 1980 in the US, the average tax rate applying to very high incomes, it was, you know, above $1 million in annual income, was on average 82%. And apparently, this did not destroy American capitalism, probably because paying top managers $10 million rather than $1 million is not so useful. In any case, all what you can, you know, it's difficult to have a quiet discussion about taxation because people get excited very quickly. It's difficult to have a quiet discussion about the public debt nowadays in Europe. But I think looking at history can be a way to have maybe not a quiet discussion, but at least a more informed discussion, and to realize that these issues, these very important issues about inequality, the public debt, taxation, you know, they did not start yesterday. They have been with us for centuries, and there's a lot to learn from this broad set of historical international experience, which I try to describe in this book. So thanks a lot for your attention.
Allora sarò brevissimo perché.
I shall be very, very brief. We're running slightly late, but I'd like to have some time for a Q&A session. I would like to refer to something that I read in the book. Piketty basically states that one of the factors to reduce inequalities is investing in knowledge and in training, basically. And it is an investment in knowledge. The microphone is gone, I'm afraid. Oh, it's working now. Sorry. Investing in knowledge and investing in this festival of the economy is also an investment in knowledge and maybe, who knows, helps reduce inequalities. Here is my first question. I got quite in love with Gini's index. He's an Italian who studied inequalities. And in 1929, inequalities peaked. So inequalities are bad for the economy as well. Well, we might talk about that in another setting. Well, you ended up talking about taxations, and you quoted our first minister, our prime minister as well. Valls basically said we taxed wealth, tax went up with the center right, and now, though, I am quite cautious on that front. What I'm worried about is to kickstart households and businesses. Businesses need to be competitive and households need to have money to spend. Well, and we talk about that in Italy too a bit. So I was wondering, is it possible to play a bit on the tax lever in order to smoothen out inequalities, or should we just push on the monetary front?
I think we are asking too much, you know, to creative monetary policies these days. You know, of course, it's much easier to print billions of euros or dollars than to change the tax code. You know, you can print billions of euros or dollars or British pounds in one day, whereas the tax code, you need the parliament to vote, that's complicated, you know, you need majority agreement. But the problem is that when you just print money, then, you know, you put it somewhere, and sometimes you create a bubble on some asset prices, real estate, stock market, and in the end, the people who really benefit from all the quantitative easing, you know, are not necessarily the people that you would like to benefit. So, you know, I think the targeting is quite poor. So, monetary policy is useful. You know, we learned after the 2008 crisis that you need, of course, central bank to prevent the financial system from a complete collapse. But we have been asking too much to this. And so in the case of Europe, you know, should we ask more to taxation? It's complicated because I think we also increased taxation too much in 2012, 2013, in particular in my country, in France, because we wanted to reduce the public deficit, I believe, too fast. We increased taxes a lot, and in the end, we have killed growth, and with, you know, very small growth in 2013, 2014, 2015, that's very difficult to reduce the public debt. The main lesson from the history of public debt is that, you know, if you have zero inflation, very small growth, it takes decades and decades to reimburse a public debt. And I think sometimes, you know, you need either inflation, a little bit more inflation, you need exceptional measures, you know, exceptional tax on private wealth, one-off tax on private wealth, or you need also some form of debt restructuring. You know, people don't like to talk about debt restructuring, but, you know, if you look at the history of public debt, take, you know, the case of Germany. You know, Germany in 1945 had over 200% of GDP in public debt. And in 1955, they had zero, 20% of GDP. What happened in between? You know, it's not that they repaid their public debt. The public debt was inflated away, very high inflation, and also there was a lot of debt restructuring. In particular, the foreign debt of Germany was reduced to zero in the London Agreement of 1953. And I think this was a good decision, because in the end, this is what allowed Germany and other European countries, you know, to start reconstruction without a big public debt. I think, you know, right now, you know, I mentioned the comparison between the budget of the university system in Italy and the interest payment. You know, I don't think that's very good for the future. If you take Europe as a whole, You know, we all like Erasmus program, but you know, Erasmus program, I check the numbers, you know, the total spendings for the entire European Union right now is two billion per year. You know, the total payment in terms of interest payment for the public debt right now is 200 billion payment per year. So is this the right proportion, you know, to prepare the future? So I think we will need, you know, in my view, we should, you know, there was this proposal by a number of German economists a couple of years ago to include all the public debt of Eurozone countries above 60% of GDP into a common redemption fund. Well, I don't know if redemption fund is the right name, but at least putting this debt into a common fund, which will make it much easier for the central bank, you know, to have an inflation target so as to have a little bit more inflation. This doesn't mean that, you know, different countries will repay for the debt of others. We will keep separate account, but at least we would have a common interest rate. You know, you cannot have such big interest rate differential and within a single currency region. We have done different measures to try to reduce that, but I think this is insufficient. And also we need, you know, more realistic perspective about the restructuring of this common debt. You know, take the case of Greece. They are supposed to repay 4% of GDP in primary budget surplus for the next 20 or 30 years. And you know, this will not happen. And I think this will be a big mistake. And, you know, luckily, this is not what we ask to Germany after World War II. And, you know, it's a, you know, I think the idea that the young generation of Greeks or Italians, you know, should just repay, of course, some mistakes were made sometimes by, you know, their parents or government of their parents, but, you know, some, the young generation of German in the 1950s, you know, some mistakes were also made by their parents and by the previous government, and still, you know, I think this was the right decision to reduce the public debt. And so this happened all the time in the history of public debt. So I think, you know, instead of waiting until the last minute and the last panic, we have to take a fresh look to these issues in Europe if we want to find solution to invest in growth and renew with growth and social progress.
Grazie. Io direi.
Thank you. Let's get a couple of questions more. I see one from here and another one, but then I'm sorry, we'll have to close. Really, a couple of questions, no more. Unfortunately, we're a bit late. That gentleman over there. And I have a young man down there. I did say a gentleman. With lots of hair.
Possible? Je pense que la production, l'index mathématique production intérieure bruto n'est pas significatif parce que nous indique seulement la quantité, non la qualité de la distribution. Pour ça, j'ai. Sì.
Perché sennò il pubblico non ha la traduzione.
Please speak English. There's no translation. Translation is only English Italian. I'm afraid no French. Apologies for that. I worked out an empirical index to measure the distribution of inequality. So inequalities in resource distribution, basically. That's what I tried to work out. I did so to try and add to the distribution and analysis because at the end of the day, the focus is placed on GDP, which provides a quantitative measure, not a quality measurement of wealth. And a small question here, the zero growth theory of Latouche. He basically says that there's no need to increase production in those industries which are saturated. Thank you. Let the young man over there, please.
Good evening. I have just one question regarding the graph that you show at the beginning concerning the changement in inequality in the history. And as far as I could see, it seems like that inequality, since the beginning of the 20th century, grew up, and the trend stopped around the time of the economical crisis of 29, and of course at the time of the two war. My question is, turning to the recent crisis, we are now hopefully recovering from the crisis, but the trend is still the same that we had before the crisis, even in countries that are not at all pro-austerity, like US, for example. Inequality is growing increasingly. So are we missing something? What we failed, in your opinion? What went wrong?
Right. So. That's a very interesting question. I think basically the policy response after the recent crisis has been insufficient. So, the good news is that we have learned after the crisis of 1929 that we need central banks to prevent the complete collapse of the financial system. And this is what we did. The central bank, as I said before, printed money so as to avoid a complete collapse of the financial system. Now, the problem is that because we did that, the good news is that we avoided a complete catastrophe, a complete depression of the same magnitude, at least in the biggest economies. In Greece, the depression between 2009 and 2015 has been as big as in France between 1929 and 1935. But for the biggest economies, we avoided this. But the bad news is that because we avoided the complete catastrophe, also there was, there was a policy response in terms of tax policy, regulatory response, what we do with the public debt. We did not have the policy response that is as strong as what happened after the crisis of 1929. Of course, after the crisis of 1929, you also had World War II, so you had, huge shocks, which made a complete change in the intellectual regime and the policy regime, and a new form of welfare state and welfare capitalism emerged after 1945. And, I'm certainly not saying that we need such a big shocks for the policy response to be adequate, but I think it's a very different kind of response, partly for the reasons that I indicated. And in the particular case of the Eurozone and Europe, I think basically we have transformed a crisis which initially came from the US private banking sector because of excessive financial deregulation, and we have managed to transform it into a European public debt crisis just because of our bad policies and institutions. It's just by our own fault, basically, because there was no more public debt in Europe than in the US or Japan before the crisis, but just because of our bad organization with a single currency and 18 different public debt, 18 different interest rate, 18 different corporate tax in competition with one another, so that large corporations pay a lower effective tax rate than small and medium-sized businesses in Italy or France or Germany. So the entire institutional setup, I think, is largely the reason for this failure. So, but we can, with better institutions, and in particular political institutions, if we get rid of unanimity rule for fiscal decision, even with a smaller number of countries, I think we could, Italy, France, Germany, we could do a lot better.
Io ringrazio il professor Piketty.
I would like to thank Professor Piketty. I would like to thank Professor Piketty. He was crystal clear. The book is even clearer. And the conclusion that he drew here is the same in the book. The story and the history of inequality is of a political nature. Thank you and have a wonderful evening.
Fare bene il proprio mestiere.
Non diventare semplicemente
un'Europa
disuguaglianza.
Significa anche impoverimento.
Un treno che parte, una scuola che apre.
Perché dovrei preoccuparmi?
Capiscono che la mafia è tanto più forte quanto una parte.
Come si fa?
La scienza ha senso.
Il contratto in sé
non sono le donne.